Tina. Tina.
Come on, dog. Game over. Time to go home. So demanding, worse than a child.
Oh, sometimes I think better.
Coffee time?
This morning, by second post.
Dear sir or gentleman, inverted commas. I don't know, you know, publishing's a gentlemanly profession. We certainly don't make much money out of it, and I don't care for these inverted commas.
Oh, it's not funny.
I know.
We'll take nothing seriously. It is the third.
Oh, my love, I do take it seriously. It's just that my manner's not always serious, that's all.
Read it.
People like you disgust me. I suppose you think you are superior, but you are not. Just because you live in a fancy flat and have a snob dog does not make you superior to decent people, inverted commas again. You are a disgusting little machine, nothing else. Your days are numbered, anon. Oh, and a P.S., as in see you anon, ha ha. Oh. It's a readily recognisable prose style.
It's persecution. Three letters now. Maybe another tomorrow, every day.
Shall we have a drink?
Later. It's because I'm Jewish.
No. It's not because you're Jewish.
Look, I know about these things. You forget my parents.
It's not because you're Jewish. Anyway, it's I he dislikes. He, she, whoever it is. I mean, I'm the one who disgusts him. You are a disgusting little machine, nothing else. I mean, it's a crank letter, love, just like all the others. It's uncomfortable to get, but no, it's not serious.
Your days are numbered. Means he wants to kill you.
Well, he may want to kill me. I often want to kill Harry Duggan at the office, but I don't do it. Your days are numbered. Could be a child. It's that kind of language. Except children nowadays never read. They only watch television. I mean, nobody on Kojak or Sweeney would say your days are numbered.
All right, I'll have a glass of sherry.
But everybody's days are numbered, when you come to think of it. Grim Reaper hones his scythe round every corner.
You won't go to the police?
No, no.
And if there's another letter tomorrow, every day?
I don't read them, tear them up. It's easy to recognise that printing. I mean, before we know, every flat in the building gets one.
They don't, I ask.
Every building in the street, disgusting little machines, every one of us.
Well, then it's a public nuisance and you should go to the police.
There's nothing they could do. Police are far too busy failing to catch burglars and chasing after the IRA. Well, they'd be very polite, because they always are. But there'd be a lot of discreet sniggering as I left the station.
Oh, you English. You English. You will put up with anything because you don't want to look foolish.
I better take Tina to the park. That won't be long. Come on then, Doc. What about walkies, eh? Are you bursting, are you? You are.
It's not every flat. Or building. He knows we have a dog. He watches us. Look, he watches us.
Can't want me to throw anything. I haven't got your ball. But you'd never find it anyway. Stick. Bit of stick. Stick. Ah. Right. Now, you just chase this bit of wood, and then we're going home. Right? Come on, dog. Come on, Tina. Fetch it. Fetch it here. Come on. Tina! 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 Come on, Tina!
Come on now, dog. You can't find it. You can't find it. Come on, Tina. I'm sorry to disturb you. I'm looking for my dog. She's a white poodle. I don't know whether you... yes, sorry.
Turn down the oven.
Yes, Tina.
Oh, God,
no, what? No, it's not an accident. It's just lost.
Lost?
I threw a stick for her in the park. She ran after it. She never came back. I can't find her.
I'll turn off the oven and get my coat.
I don't understand.
We'll need torches, two of them. The flashlights, one each. We'll look together. She may be hurt.
There's one in the broom cupboard, I think. Tina!
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 Tina! Tina! Tina!
No good, love. I shan't be able to eat it.
Well, it's always better the next day, anyway.
You're not going to have any? I'll telephone the police tomorrow morning. Oh. Our name's on the collar and the addresses. Someone could have found her. We may hear tomorrow.
Who would steal her?
Nobody.
Well, somebody.
I didn't see anybody. I mean, I don't think people do steal dogs. Oh, we'll hear something tomorrow. We're bound to. I'll ask at the police station. You know, we'll put an advertisement in the Chelsea Post, offer a reward. I'll write out a card for the newsagent's window. There's lots of things we can do. And I'll get up first thing tomorrow morning, I'll go out again in daylight. We'll find her.
Yes.
Come on, you go to bed. I'll just read for a bit.
And oh,
I'll...
no!
No, all right. I've got a manuscript to finish, but I can read it in bed. I just turn out the lights, then I'll come.
Tina! Good dog! Tina! Come here, Tina.
Dear sir or gentleman, inverted commas again. I have your poodle dog, Tina. If you want her back, leave £200 in used fibres wrapped in newspaper behind railings by traffic lights up from Park Gate and Albert Bridge Road Friday night, 11 p.m. If you do this, the dog will be left tied to same railings 1 hour later. If you tell cops or set watch, your dog will be killed. A nice little dog, ha ha. I think she's nicer than you, Anon. It's a great one for inverted commas. He spells Knight, N-I-H-G-T. I don't know if that's a clue.
You can't go to the police.
Well, clearly we should.
No, no, you can't. You must get her back first.
Yes.
£200.
She only cost us 30. Oh, there's the Epivax, of course, and all those vet bills. And the Kennel Club registration.
It's insane.
Yes, it must be. I mean, kidnapping a pet dog, I mean, it's mad. Couldn't have been planned. Nobody knew that I was going to throw that piece of wood into the bushes. She insisted.
I told you, he watches us. You should read our other letters.
Are there any bills? Look, are you so sure that it's a he?
Oh, yes, yes. No woman would do that.
Perhaps it's a they.
Perhaps.
Well, what are we going to do, love?
It's not the money.
Oh, a nicely calculated amount. We want Tina back. Insofar as one does love a dog, we love her.
Insofar? She's ours. What's insofar?
Well, yes, we love her. Coffee?
No, thank you.
£200 is neither here nor there. One doesn't like giving in, that's the point. Being held to ransom, that's the problem. Used fibres in inverted commas. Clearly he's a great reader of cheap detective fiction. And all for a dog. Oh, well. I'm going to be late. Will you phone?
Yes. That little girl last year, they killed her.
Hmm?
And the Black Panther business before that, well, they're both dead.
Well, there'd be no point in killing a dog.
They kill a child and not a dog?
Oh, yes, yes, yes. They kill a child, kill any human being who's been kidnapped because they're afraid of being identified, tracked down. They daren't return the victim. A dog can't talk, can't pick anyone out at an identity parade. There'd be no reason to kill Tina. There's no reason why we shouldn't get her back.
So you will leave the money?
Oh, yes, I'll go to the bank today. Now, look, we'll keep this letter and we'll put it with the other three. And we'll take the whole lot down to the police station when we've got Tina back.
Coffee, yes, something. 10 feet.
Tina? Tina!
Yes, it is late, past one. Oh, yes, I will turn the music down. No, I'll turn it off if it annoys you. Sorry.
A dog.
Yes. Well, I thought that since there was money involved, you know, an actual demand for money...
Which you say you paid.
Paid, yes. I've brought the letters with me. I imagine you'll want to see them.
The letters, yes. Would you be good enough to wait in the waiting room on your right, sir? And I'll arrange with someone to take a statement.
A statement?
It all begins with paper, sir. All police work. No crime really exists until it's been written down.
Oh.
We shan't keep you long.
Oh, right, thank you. I suppose that you think I was very stupid to have paid the money, hmm?
I'll have someone come and see you right away, sir.
Right, thank you.
Can you believe it?
What was it? Bombs in Wharton Street, hot and Peabody buildings, drunken drivers everywhere you look. There are 15 unsolved break-ins every day in this area alone. And he comes in to complain that some geezer, or geezers unknown, have nicked his bloody poodle.
Well, it is a felony.
And demanded 200 nicker to give it back. And you know what? He's paid it.
That's kidnapping.
It is kidnapping a dog, Constable. A bow wow, a pooch.
Would you like me to take a statement?
You're just coming off shift, aren't you?
Oh, I don't mind.
We'll leave it to the CID, shall we?
These are the letters. The first came 3 weeks ago.
Three?
One a week.
Weeks ago?
Yes, I kept them with the envelopes. I don't know where the fingerprints would be.
Oh, they have been through the post office, Mr. Reynolds.
Oh, but only the envelopes, I think. Anyway, the writing, it's in capital letters, but it's quite distinctive. I mean, I imagine a handwriting expert would make something of that. Hmm?
I imagine he would, sir, yes.
I mean, I can't be the only person he writes to. You may have had other complaints.
We'll certainly check that aspect of it, sir.
I don't know whether there's a central register of anonymous letters or, you know, classified.
I don't believe there is, sir. People don't usually report them. They tear them up.
What, threats of death?
Unless they're political. Anything political is bound to be recorded. I wouldn't say these were political, though, would you?
Oh, no, well, clearly they're not political.
There's a lot of celebrities live in this area. Television personalities, pop stars, people like that. You'd be surprised at the sort of people who receive anonymous letters nowadays. All sorts of filth. They tear them up.
But my dog has been stolen.
Yes, sir, Tina, with your name and address in the collar, as you say. Well, anyone finding her would be more likely to bring her back to you than report to us. You could, of course, try Battersea Dogs Home in case the collar should have become detached from the dog. No small piece of jewellery or anything like that in the collar, I take it?
No.
Rhinestones, something for show, no real value?
No.
Oh, probably still wearing the collar then, sir.
Aren't you even going to look at the letters? Have a look at them.
We will look at them, sir. You've told me what they contain.
Look, whoever stole our dog knows where we live. I mean, it's clearly the same person, you know, the anonymous letters, the ransom note. It's clearly the same.
Exactly, sir.
Do you think that I'll hear again?
I hope so, that this time, if you do, you'll report it to us before leaving any further money.
Well, we're very fond of the dog. We want her back.
I've told you, sir, we will look into it. Dog napping. Not exactly a common crime. I can't say I've heard of it before. But if there's anything in criminal records, we'll find it. But you haven't given me very much to go on, sir. You saw nobody acting suspiciously in the park at the time. You've noticed nobody in particular hanging about near your home.
Well, we live on the river. I mean, all kinds of people hang about all the time. They look at the water.
Exactly, sir. Nobody in particular. The dog Tina was not accustomed to fraternize with strangers, nor was she on heat. As I say, sir, it's very little to go on. But we will look into it thoroughly. Meanwhile, if there was to be a further approach, as it might be a demand for a further sum of money.
But he said that if we got in touch with the police, he would kill the dog. He, they, whoever.
Well, you have got in touch with us now, sir. And you really can't go on leaving parcels of fivers between the railings of Battersea Park, can you? There'd be no sense in it.
No.
Mm. I can sign this, sir. You sign here and here.
No, thank you. Will that rule it?
Yes, sir. We'll be in touch if we find anything.
Oh. Shall I telephone?
I shouldn't bother, sir. We'll let you know.
Oh, well, thank you very much, officer.
You bloody pick him, don't you?
Here's your tea.
Oh, it's up.
Aren't you going to do anything?
What's to do?
Find the kidnapper?
Do you realise that there are 15 cases of...
He realises. I've already drawn it to his attention.
Anyway, there's nothing to go on. He never saw anybody. Nobody's been hanging about outside. Just those letters. Waste of time.
Well, I should have thought there's something to go on.
All right, Clary.
Well, if it was a child, we'd be falling over.
It's not a child, it's a dog.
Well, psychologically, it's the same thing. Child substitute in terms of the
actual state of feelings. You're trying to tell me if a couple of your puffy Cambridge friends lost a pet poodle, you'd expect me...
I don't think I have any homosexual friends, actually.
Are you bloody suggesting
that
I might?
I think there's just as much homosexuality in the East End as at any of the universities.
I said, all right, Clary.
May I?
And what does your Cambridge education tell you about that, Constable?
Well... It was written by a foreigner. That's a Continental Seven. The uprights cross through. The English don't do that. We're not taught like that. So he's probably German, French, Italian. That's a start. If you wanted a start. A crime has been committed.
All right, Dummel, don't teach me my job.
Duamel, actually.
Dummel, as in dumbbell. Don't teach me my job, dumbbell.
Just cool it, Tom, will you? Clary, if you're going off shift, isn't it time you went?
All right. Sorry.
Clary.
Well, he doesn't like Clarence. Not as a name, would you? And I can't get my tongue round, well, Duamel.
Clary. It's a girl's name. Suits him. Girly double.
Yeah, he's not a poof, Tom. He's got a bird over in Wandsworth.
Well, he's not a flaming couple, I know that for a start. Continental Seven, bloody university. He's got no business in the force. You might as well have packies. You might as well have blacks. He really gets on my wick.
You want these?
No. He really gets on my wick, you know.
Pete, what you got? It's a dog's collar.
Oh, is it about the dog?
Yes.
Come in.
Thank you. Edward and Gina Reynolds, who live in Chelsea, have been receiving anonymous letters. Then, one winter evening, their dog is kidnapped, and the same anonymous writer demands a ransom. But even though they've paid it, the dog has not been returned.
And the police will do nothing at all.
You can see the police point of view, sir. There's nothing much can be done. And with the manpower shortage, we haven't got the...
Yes, but your colleague gave me the impression that...
We have to give an impression, sir. It's bad for public confidence if the police admit straight out they can't be bothered. I shouldn't think he gave you much hope, though, did he?
No, he didn't give me much hope.
You didn't actually see anyone. There's only the anonymous letters to go on.
No, but surely that's something, the letters. Well, apparently... Maybe others have had such letters.
Most people tear them up. Look here, I really don't understand. I mean, if we're not supposed to know nothing's going to be done, why are you here?
Well, I agree with your wife, sir. Obviously, I'm speaking unofficially. I'm off shift, actually. But I do think something could be done. I thought I'd like to have a try, if that's all right.
A try?
That's very kind. Would you like some more coffee?
Thank you. It's very good. It's not instant, is it?
My wife's German. We don't drink instant. Look here. You were saying?
Well, I expect you studied the letters yourself while you had them.
Oh, yes.
Did you notice the way they were addressed? Flat 7?
Well, what about it? This is flat 7.
It was a continental 7. The upright was crossed through.
Oh, I see. Oh, yes, of course. Cake?
Oh, thank you.
That's very smart. He's very smart, Ned.
Oh, very cute.
Thank you. I haven't had a chance to study the letters myself, but they're still at the station, so I can get photocopies. You didn't notice the postmark by any chance?
SW11.
Battersea.
As Gina says that he watches us, whoever he is.
He'd have to watch to know about the dog.
Yes, well, I told your colleague so. He seemed to think very little of it. He said that if we had another demand for money, we should let him know. You'd set a trap, I imagine.
A stakeout, yes.
No, you can't do that. He would kill her.
Sorry?
Yes, the ransom note threatened to kill the dog if we set any kind of watch, in inverted commas.
Sorry?
Our correspondent has a rather curious habit of placing certain words in inverted commas, dear sir or gentleman in inverted commas. When you've time to study the letters, you'll notice.
Oh, right. Well, anyway, you can see we're already getting somewhere. We know he's foreign, French, German, European anyway. Then he doesn't start out as a kidnapper. That's an afterthought. Mm.
He couldn't have known that I was going to throw that piece of...
Right. So what he chiefly does is write anonymous letters. Probably to more people than yourselves. A cranky person living alone, I'd say. And he has time to watch the house by day and night, therefore not working. Unemployed, on a pension, or anyway unemployable. Now you see the picture?
Yes.
And living across the river. Battersea, Wandsworth, Lavender Hill.
Yes.
Now, somebody like that would probably be known to the social services. Of course, we couldn't ask officially.
Why not?
Well, the social services don't always get on with the police. We have no access to their information, actually. Anyway, I don't want to raise your hopes. There isn't more than a 1 in 4 chance. But if you would like me to look into it unofficially...
Oh, please, yes.
My wife and I have no children. We're very fond of the dog.
There's a close friend of mine, a girl I used to know at Cambridge, actually. She works for Wandsworth Social Services. She might be able to help.
Were you at Cambridge?
Yes.
Which college?
Downing.
Oh, good for the police. I was at Trinity.
No.
Yeah.
Well, I'm afraid I stick out rather among my colleagues at the police station. Like a sore thumb, actually.
What?
I only photocopied them. I put them back.
What's that supposed to mean? It's no business of yours.
Well, I was interested.
Interested? And who are you to be interested? That's my work, girl.
But you're not doing it, are you?
What did you say?
Apologize.
Sorry.
Accept it. All right.
Well, I thought I might be able to help. See, there are a number of points, actually, when you study the letters, more than just his being foreign. I made a few notes, if you'd like to see them.
Just stuff them, girly, and keep off my patch.
Girly? Oh, that's new, that is. That's really witty. He's in publishing. I really like them, actually. I felt right away they were my kind of people.
Well, what do you mean, your kind of people? Your father's a builder.
Sickening bloody CID. They won't even try unless they think they can get a conviction. It's called conservation of effort. You show any intelligence or initiative and they resent it. And as for education, I don't pretend. I told the Reynolds so myself. I was quite frank. I don't pretend there's more than a 1 in 4 chance, but I'd like to do what I can.
Clary, you're not doing what you can.
What? Well, we're going to. I mean, we don't often talk. Not really talk. Not the way we used to.
You didn't come over here to talk about police work. I hate the fuss.
Well, no, of course not. Well, at least I did in a way. I'd rather talk about your work, actually.
About my work?
Yes.
In what way, actually?
We're both idealists, aren't we? I mean, your ideals took you into the social services and mine took me into the police.
No, your ambition took you into the police, Clary. And a degree in sociology took me into the social services. Now, let's get on with it.
Now, look, look. I want to help these people. I mean, somebody's persecuting them. Somebody stole their dog.
Oh!
Oh, come on. Didn't you ever love an animal?
Yes, ponies. But that was sexual.
It was one of your clients, an old lady living alone, say. If somebody stole her budgie, then...
All right, Clary, you made your point.
Right. Now, we'll call our villain Chummy.
You call your villain Chummy and I'll stop listening.
We'll call him anything. I've got photocopies of the letters. I've studied them. I know a lot about him. He probably lives alone. He's got an outsized chip on his shoulder, hates anyone more fortunate than himself. He has a lot of time on his hands, unemployed, pensioner.
So far you're describing about half my caseload.
He writes letters.
They all write letters, those that can write.
He's almost certainly foreign. European foreign, not black or anything. He's got a funny habit of putting unexpected words in inverted commas.
Oh, you mean Mr. Kowajinski?
What?
Well, he's always writing letters and he puts everything in inverted commas. So-called social services. He's a hard man to like.
Why?
Why is he hard to like?
Yes.
He just is. A lot of our clients are. It's not their fault, it's the system. If they weren't dislikable before, they become dislikable in various ways.
What's his way?
Well, he was a milkman with the express dairies. It was solitary, it suited him. And then a delivery van ran into his float. Well, he couldn't do his old job when he came out of hospital. He still limps. They gave him a lump sum in compensation, but he doesn't like banks, so he put the money in his mattress and consequently...
Stolen?
Of course. He's unemployable now, lives off Social Security. We often see him. Accommodation problems mainly. He's not an easy tenant. And paranoid since he had his money stolen.
Kowajinski,
Mr. Kowajinski. He's Polish.
I said he would be.
Well, he is.
Any family?
A sister. I don't think he sees her. She runs a delicatessen in Ealing or somewhere. It's a funny thing about him being Polish. Well, he's a Churchill freak.
What do you mean, Churchill freak?
Well, he's got pictures of him and books. I mean, you'd think a Pole would be anti-Churchill, what with the murder of Sikorsky.
Oh, and sending all the Poles back to Russia after the war.
I suppose it's the idea of leadership that appeals to him, poor sod. Anyway, I shouldn't be telling you all this. It's confidential.
Where's he live?
Oh, Clary, you'd be such a good lover if you weren't a policeman. As it is, I only fancy you for the lovely downy fluff on your bum.
I don't know what you mean about my ambition taking me into the force. The pay is terrible, and the hours are worse.
Clary.
Your dog is alive and well, but I have decided that the situation warrants another £100, which I feel sure a man in your position can well afford. I'm going to leave £100 in the same place. This time he guarantees the dog will be returned.
Oh, don't say the dog. She has a name.
Sorry.
No, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to snap. I'm upset.
No, it's all right. Oh, well, there's no option now. I suppose I shall have to contact that detective. He said if we heard again...
But you can't. You mustn't. He will kill her. Look, it says here, alive and well. Alive and well, Ned. We've given up hope, and it says alive and well, and this time he guarantees...
Miss, but can we believe that, love? You know, can we believe that? I mean, we can't just go on leaving packets of used fibres. We can't go on.
Well, then you must ring the young man, the constable.
What's the difference?
He said there was a 1 in 4 chance that he could find the... If he finds the man where he lives, he'll find Tina and we can get her back. You said you'd let him help.
Yes, but this note, love, I mean, it changes everything.
It changes nothing. He's a nice young man. You liked him. He went to Cambridge. He wants to help.
Are you there, Mr. Kovacinski? I know you're in there.
Go away.
He's in there, his lights on.
Beach. Go away.
He speaks to me. I don't know why I put up with it. I'll tell you straight.
Mr. Kovacinski! Open up, please, Mr. Kovacinski. It's police.
I want to talk to you, Mr. Kovacinski. I want to ask you some questions. Now then, no idea why I'm here then? Nothing on your conscience, Mr. Kovacinski? All right, where's the dog?
Zostov mne vespokoyum.
Sorry?
Yet is Mariam Pangelsku.
Don't speak English, eh? Nein sprechen English, mein Herr?
Nein. Ne.
Funny. Didn't do a bad job of telling the landlady to get lost. Forgotten all your English since then, have you? It's funny how the sight of a uniform affects people's memories. Like, for instance, you've been resident in this country since 1939. You held down a job with the express dairies for 15 years. How did you manage to deliver all that milk, all those eggs, all those wrapped loaves without speaking a word of English, Mr. Kovacinski?
How you find out these things about me?
Oh, I have my sources. Where's the dog?
Maybe I'm some...
Where's that dog?
You all right in there?
Please, go away. Nobody's going to get hurt.
All right, I'm going.
And let me hear you go. You've been writing anonymous letters, Mr. Kovacinski.
No.
That's an offence. Harassment, breach of the peace.
No.
I could take you in for that, take you into the police station. You could assist me with my inquiries. Will you believe I rode in my college 8? I've got very muscular arms.
I do nothing. Arrest me. You see, look. No dog here.
Oh, you got a dog? What sort of dog?
No dog here.
Oh, you've been keeping a dog? The landlady won't like that. Where is it?
No dog here.
You got it somewhere else, have you? Locked up?
I don't know what you mean.
And the letters?
I never write no letters.
Never? Not to your sister? Not even to your social worker?
Psychiatrist.
Sorry?
I don't write no anonymous letters.
Oh, I think you do. I don't approve of Churchill, actually. He was overrated in my view. I don't think you should burn candles to him, Mr. Kovacinski. He certainly wasn't a saint.
You leave me alone, mister. Nothing wrong here. You see for yourself.
I am doing. And what I see is a writing pad and a ballpoint pen, but you don't write letters.
There.
And what I have here are photostats of anonymous letters written by a man who went on to steal a dog and demanded money before he would give it back. That's called demanding money with menaces, Mr. Kovacinski. A very serious offence.
No dog here.
And all these letters are written on cheap, lined paper just like this, with a ballpoint pen just like this. Would you write something for me, please, Mr. Kovacinski? Sit down. You'll be more comfortable.
Do you want me to ride?
Start with dear sir. No, not like that. Print it.
What good is printing? You can't tell anything.
Can't you? Oh, I think you can. A handwriting expert can. Anyway, the letters are printed. The anonymous letters are printed. I expect whoever wrote these letters thought we couldn't tell anything if he printed. But he was quite wrong. Do you always print like that? It looks as if you're trying to disguise it.
I write how I write. You don't like it? I don't care.
Print, dear sir or gentleman. Very interesting. Why did you put gentleman in inverted commas, Mr. Kovacinski? No one else would. I'll keep this. You wrote the letters. It's easy to prove. You stole the dog. Your silence gives consent, Mr. Kovacinski. Mr. and Mrs. Reynolds don't want to send you to prison. They only want their dog back. If they get their dog back, safe and sound, they'd be quite prepared to drop the whole thing, actually.
The dog is with my sister.
In?
Where she lives.
Where's that, exactly?
You don't know.
I do know. Roughly.
You don't know.
Well, I don't know exactly.
You don't know where my sister lives, Mr. Policeman. You don't know.
I can easily find out.
You're going to ask this social worker?
I don't know what you're talking about.
You found out those things about me. That I have one sister, that I come to England in 1939, that I work for the dairy. You think I'm a fool? Don't you never write no letters, you say? Not to this social worker? Bloody true. I write to this social worker. They do nothing for me. They find me a pigsty to live. My leg is hurt. Only one way you can find out those things about me is confidential. You make a big mistake, I think.
Just tell me where your sister lives. I'll collect the dog. We'll say no more about it. No more hassle.
No. You know, I have written again to that snob.
Mr. Reynolds.
He must leave £100 in the same place. Then he will get his poodle dog back. No more hassle.
There's no question of that. I can take you into the station and collect the dog from your sister tomorrow.
If I do not phone my sister tonight, she will kill the dog.
Then you'd better phone now and tell her not to.
No. Take me in. Let the dog die. I go to jail. One dead dog makes no difference. What good help you give your snob friend? Hmm? You kill his dog. He will love you, I think.
How? How does your sister intend to kill the dog? Never mind.
Now, I tell you what to do. Go away. Tell your snob friend he leaves £100 or the dog is dead.
I told you there's no question of... I don't think you realize the extent of your offense. I think you should be grateful.
Poor little dog. Poor Tina.
I'll have to talk to Mr. Reynolds.
Talk? Come back. I wait.
Is there a telephone in the house?
Nema?
Will you wait here? I'm going to phone. And you better realize there's no question of paying any further money. It's just a question of getting the dog back, that's all. I'll take this with me.
Fool, the little dog is dead already. Poor little dog, poor Tina.
Reynolds, Clarence Dowell. Constable de Hamel, I found him. There's rather a snag, actually. Well, apparently the dog is with his sister.
What does he say?
No, there's no question of that, Clarence. We want the dog back. Tell him we'll leave the money. There's only £100 after all. You can always pick him up when we've got Tina back. Oh, yes, I certainly do intend to prefer charges.
Clarence Duhamel is a police constable. Acting entirely unofficially and behind the back of a CID colleague who can't be bothered with the case, he has tracked down Kowajinski, the kidnapper of a dog belonging to Edward and Gina Reynolds. Kowajinski has already collected £200 in ransom and has demanded a further 100. threatening that if he doesn't get it or Clarence arrests him, the dog would be killed. In fact, the dog is already dead.
I don't see any option. I mean, I've got the money. I told you, I've got it ready.
So there's no problem, really, Mr. Reynolds. We can do a stakeout and catch him in the act.
We shall not do a stakeout, Constable. If we do any such thing, the dog will be killed. We'll try to avoid that.
It's not polite, Ned. You can't call him Clarence one minute, Constable the next, as if he'd become an enemy.
That's all right, Mrs. Reynolds.
Yes, I'm sorry. I shouldn't have. I'm sorry, Clarence.
What if he doesn't bring the dog? He didn't before. If he just takes the money and goes away again.
Yes, there is that chance.
This time he promised.
Yes, but he promised last time.
It'll just be another 100 down the drain.
Oh, well, if it is, it is. I mean, there's any number of ways the middle classes can throw their money down the drain. Eating out, going to the opera, Oxfam, the Inland Revenue. I mean, money goes anyway. What's £100, more or less, to a Polish psychopath? If there's even the smallest chance of getting our dog back. I told you we're very fond of her.
Please don't cry, Mrs. Reynolds. I know how you feel.
Look, I'll take the money, and I'll leave it as before, all right?
Yes.
Look, I don't want you with me, Clarence. He may have some way.
Oh, I think
look,
I should be with
I
you.
I just don't want you anywhere near Battersea Park tonight. We'll play it his way.
He'll be back soon.
Yes. There's no hope, I suppose.
Would you like to play something?
It's late. The neighbors would complain.
Yes. I suppose they would.
I'll play something quiet.
Your husband said you played at the Wigmore Hall.
There were 8 people in the audience. Michael Oliver from the BBC, the Times music critic, and Ned's board of directors. No. I don't play professionally anymore. Another time, perhaps.
I'd like that.
You don't have to tell us, Ned. Your face tells us.
I have to report it, I suppose. You're better if I do, actually.
I mean, I have to anyway.
You don't sound very eager.
They're bound to be vexed.
You did what?
It seemed to be the best thing to do at the time, sir. I mean, they're very nice people. Good address and that sort of thing. When nothing was being done to help them. Under the circumstances,
oh, God, give me patience.
We are supposed to use our initiative, sir. On examination of the anonymous letters, I noticed that... Well, it seemed to me there was a good chance of finding the man. I did mention this to the CID, sir, but they didn't seem interested. They made rather a joke of it, actually.
Who made a joke of it?
It was Detective Constable Choley's case, sir. I did find the man. He's got away with £300 altogether. I know his name and can give an exact description.
Ask Detective Constable Choley to see me, please.
Oh, wait outside. You'll give Choley every piece of information you have about this case, and you will never, under any circumstances, meddle in CID matters again.
I'll ask you again. Where's the rest of the money?
You took.
No, Mr. Kowajinski, that's not true. Now, you must tell the truth, you know. The police do not take money. Now, the money that was found in your room is in safe custody. You've been given a receipt for it, and in time, it'll be returned to the proper owner, which, by your own confession, is not you.
Only where's the rest of it?
I bought the coat, I bought the hat.
How much you say you pay for it?
You know how much. I've showed you the bill.
Suit you.
Problem is, Mr. Kowajinski, take away the hat, take away the coat, take away 2 cups of coffee and a Danish pastry purchased at Gloriette's Cafe during the course of the morning shopping. Take away a large whiskey bought in the pub. We're still exactly £50 short.
And what we'd like to know, you know, just as a matter of form, what you might call the tidying up element...
I've told you.
You mustn't interrupt, Mr. Kowajinski. It's not polite.
I speak truth. You don't listen. I gave the money. Don't hit me!
Stand up. It's not an acceptable answer, Mr. Kowajinski. What you've told us about the £50 so far, it's not acceptable. Take your coat off.
Allow me.
Take your belt off. Can't let you keep this. You might hang yourself with this. Do yourself a damage. Cheat justice. Take off your braces. Bloody pole! My dad served 5 years in the Royal Army Ordnance Corps to save the likes of you.
No, I am anti-communist, against communists.
So am I, mate, so am I. I am a true blue conservative, anti-communist to a fault.
Verging on fascist.
Verging, as my colleague observes, on fascist.
Don't hit me.
Have I touched you?
We don't hit people, Mr. Kowajinski. Not the public. And certainly not those members of the public who cooperate with our inquiries. Now, pull your trousers up, Mr. Kowajinski. Your comms are indecent. I vote liberal myself. But if it should be your desire for reasons of political equality to be interrogated by a socialist copper, I've no doubt we can arrange it.
So what have you done with the other £50? What's so funny?
I burned it.
That's not funny at all. That's a more unlikely story than the other.
Believe what you want.
Just tell us what you did with the £50. We've got your confession to the rest.
I tell you the truth.
Sit down, Mr. Kowajinski. Oh, don't stand on ceremony. Make yourself comfortable. Now, you stand by your original story that you actually gave the money
to... I said so. How many times you want me to tell you?
Well, I think we have to accept the possibility that he might be telling the truth. Who is he?
Duhamel. I was told you wanted formal identification.
Come in, girly.
You found him, then?
Oh, it wasn't difficult, girly. He was bound to be one of those cheap bed and breakfast places. A few phone calls, a little legwork. Nothing complicated. Nothing on a par with your deductive abilities, girly. Continental Sevens and liaison with the social services tracking him down.
I wish you wouldn't call me girly.
Suit you. Couldn't call you Clary like what all your friends do. Too effeminate. Kane here at Auntie Clary. Run a brothel in Pompey. A right madam she was.
Oh, that she was. That
never
she
mind.
Was. What's all this like what stuff? Can't you talk proper?
It's how girly expects us to talk. Being mere common policemen and lacking the advantages of a Cambridge education.
Oh, very funny.
Wait, 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 girly! Wait. There's something here you ought to know. Something that concerns you.
Well?
We've got this little problem. Chummy here says he gave you £50 to let him go.
What?
Oh, you found him just like you said. You confronted him with the evidence. And he offered you £50 to let him go. And you took the money. And he scarpered.
Well, he's lying, isn't he?
That's what we've been trying to find out. But so far, it looks as if he might be telling the truth.
But the complainant offered you money, to wit £50, if you would go away and allow him to effect his escape. And that you accepted the money and did go away, and he did escape. Well, have you anything to say?
Oh, I did go away, sir. The man had threatened to have the dog killed. I thought I ought to telephone the dog's owners, Mr. and Mrs. Reynolds. I did phone them, they'll corroborate that. Then I returned.
To find that the complainant had, in fact, escaped?
Yes.
Well, do you want to say anything, Inspector Clark, as Duhamel's reporting officer?
Only that Constable Duhamel has been with the force for 3 years, attached to this precinct. He's been a conscientious officer of exemplary character. There've been no previous complaints against him of any kind.
Yes, well, the complaint will be investigated by officers of Scotland Yard, the Complaints Investigation Bureau. You will hold yourself available for questioning at all times. You'll report your whereabouts daily to your superior, and should you have any occasion to leave your place of residence, you must let the station know where you can be found.
Any occasion, sir?
Well, obviously not if you're going shopping or to the cinema, but any substantial occasion.
Overnight, sir?
Why would you be spending the nights away?
If I was spending the night with a friend, sir.
Are you trying to tell me you have some woman tucked away somewhere? You did say exemplary character.
I do sometimes spend the night with a friend, sir. A female friend.
I see. Well, if you do, you'll have to let the station know, won't you? Address and phone number.
Yes, sir.
Right, well, you're suspended from duties from now. Please give your warrant card to the inspector.
Sir.
You're entitled to a copy of the complaint against you. This is Form 163, the official form for complaints against the police. Now, don't lose it. You may need it for reference.
Sir.
Oh, for God's sake, man, don't look so hangdog. If you can prove your innocence, you've nothing to worry about.
Sir.
Well, you can go home now. Don't hang about the station. CIB will let you know when they want to see you.
Sir.
I suppose if he's got some woman tucked away somewhere, he might need the money. However, it's not up to us, thank God.
Now, you say you wish to plead guilty. Are you sure you understand that? Do you understand that demanding money with menaces is a serious charge, and you have the right to go to a higher court and defend yourself before a jury?
I understand. I stay here.
What?
He says he understands that, madam, and will accept the judgment of this court.
Does he know he's entitled to legal aid?
That has been explained to him, madam. He doesn't want it.
Very well. Is anything known?
Nothing known, madam.
No offence is known to the police at all, of any sort?
Nothing, madam.
And he's no fixed abode?
No, madam.
This is all very unsatisfactory. Are we going to hear from the social services about this?
Oh, yes, madam. Mr. Kojinski is known to the social services.
Then why have you been unable to find him somewhere to live?
We have, madam, on several occasions. In our experience, he won't stay longer than a few months. He tends to fall out with the landlord.
Is there any psychiatric history?
There's a medical history, madam, an accident to his leg.
Hardly the same thing. The nature of this offence is so very peculiar. Clearly, we shall require a psychiatric report. Can you arrange attendance at a psychiatric clinic as an outpatient?
If he'll go, madam.
Of course he'll go. If the court orders him to go, he'll go.
Yes, madam.
I believe most of the money has been recovered.
Yes, madam. Most of it.
Then, have the police any objections to bail?
No objections, madam.
Very well. Remanded for a psychiatric report on his own recognizance, bail to be set at £10 with 7 days to pay. We'll see him again in 3 weeks. Do you understand that, Kojinski? You're to pay £10 bail into the court from your social security money, and you're to go to a clinic and see the psychiatrist there every day for as long as he wants to see you. And you must stay out of trouble. You'll be brought here again in 3 weeks.
And a constable came to you without encouragement or solicitation on your part and offered to undertake the inquiry himself and attempt to recover the dog?
Yes.
Without any...
Without any inquiry or solicitation. He'd seen me at the station. The case had been discussed there. Consequently, he knew my name and address.
It's very irregular.
It's not a crime to help the public.
No, it's very irregular.
There are regular ways of assisting the public, madam, and irregular ways.
Yes, well, the regular way in this case was to do nothing whatever about my complaint.
Well, in this case, sir, that might be so. Now, the force is undermanned, particularly in London, and the recovery of a dog would not be a first priority.
Yes, well, in this case, Constable de Hamel noticed certain points about the anonymous letters which he thought might lead to the tracing of the person who had written them. He brought them to the attention of the detective in charge of the case and was ignored. Well, it seems to me perfectly natural that he should want to follow them up.
It may be natural to want to do so, sir. Most of us want to do a great many things in this life which we don't do, from rape to travelling on public transport without a ticket. He was irregular to approach you and offer to undertake an inquiry himself.
Consequently, we must ask ourselves whether he had any other motive which was not stated at the time.
What other motive?
We don't know, sir.
We ask ourselves the question, sir. We do not yet come up with an answer.
A bad motive? To get money from us. Something. How?
Well, if you believe that, knowing the man, I mean, you can believe anything.
Well, we don't know him, sir. Investigations of this nature are carried out by officers unknown to the policemen under investigation.
The aim is to assist the public.
You know him well, do you, sir? I was under the impression...
Well, we feel that we've come to know him, yes.
Only have to talk to him for 2 minutes to know he's an innocent.
Innocent of what, madam?
An innocent. It is his nature. Oh, he's a child in some ways. A boy. Should not be in the police.
If I hadn't told you about the letters to the department in inverted commas, you'd never have found him. It was a betrayal of confidence. So, what am I doing eating spaghetti with a policeman? I hate the fuzz.
You don't hate me, I think.
I do hate you. I'm dripping it on your sweater.
We're lovers, aren't we?
We've been lovers. I'm not so sure now. Maybe it's time for a change.
I was thinking we might get married, actually.
Isn't it usual to live together for a bit first?
Police don't like that. They don't approve of that. I think policemen should be married, not sleep around. We're supposed to be of exemplary moral character.
You haven't been sleeping around. You've been sleeping with me.
Same thing to them.
I see.
See, up to now, they've not known about it. I mean, they've known I've got a girl. I've let that be known.
God.
Well, you've got to make sure they know that, or they think you're gay.
What would it matter if you were?
It would matter to them. Well, what they don't know is that I sleep here most nights. Now they'll have to know.
Why?
Now I'm under investigation. I have to report where I am all the time.
You mean you have to tell them? Actually tell them?
Mm.
Phone up and tell them I'm about to spend the night with Marion Dowell, a social worker of 37 Abbotsford Terrace, Southwest 11.
With the phone number?
It's not even my phone. It's our phone. All the people in the house, we share it.
Well, I have to tell them.
Wouldn't it be better if you didn't spend the night?
I need you. I'm in trouble.
I have a caseload of clients. They need me. They're in trouble. You haven't been coming over here as a client.
I haven't been coming here just to... I'm not a stud. Mm. I'm not a machine for sex. I'm a human being. We were friends at Cambridge.
Oh, Cambridge, Cambridge. Grow up, Clary. You're not an undergraduate anymore. You talk about Cambridge as if it was some sort of moral attribute. It's just a university. You're in love with the idea of being a Cambridge man. Well, those days are gone. There aren't any Cambridge men anymore, even at Cambridge. The whole idea is quite gone out.
Not for me.
Poor Clary. There's more downstairs if you want it.
Well, I suppose it does sound snobbish, actually, but when you spend your working life with people who... I mean, they're all right. I like them, most of them. I don't go on about the fuzz the way you do. I'm one of them, only they're not... Obviously, they're not our kind of people. That's why Cambridge is important to me. It reminds me of what sort of person I am.
Why didn't you go into the BBC or an advertising agency like everyone else? But you get this mad idea.
I wanted to do good.
Oh, don't lie!
All right, and I thought it'd be politically useful later on to have the experience. All right. I'm not going to stay in the police forever. I'm young, I can spare the time. But I wanted to do good. I thought I'd be helping people. Why else did you go into social work? I mean, you could have got a job in television.
Oh, that's right, I forgot. They turned you down.
That's not very kind, actually.
I don't want to fight with you. I'm fond of you. Even your being good in bed, that's part of what you call wanting to do good, I suppose. Well, you like to give pleasure, which is more than most men care about.
Thank you.
If only you didn't have these ideas of yourself. Clarence the Cambridge man, Clarence the scourge of crime, Clarence the politician. I don't know. I don't want you ringing up and telling them who you're going to. I don't want that. And when I've been thinking, I've actually been thinking you shouldn't come over here so often. And now you're in trouble. It's the worst time. You're like a little boy. You really bug me.
I need you.
What?
He's outside the window. Down there. He's watching the house.
Thank you.
Constable Clarence Duhamel has been suspended from duty, accused of taking £50 as a bribe from a man who had kidnapped and killed a dog and whom he had tracked down.
He's watching the house.
Now the man, Kowajinski, is watching the house where Clarence's girlfriend lives.
Go up.
Leave him.
He's watching us.
Let him.
He's mad. I suppose you know that. He's been remanded for a psychiatric report.
I told you he'd been remanded for a psychiatric report.
You don't know what he might do, a man like that. If he'll accuse me, just invent an accusation, if he'll accuse me of taking £50.
Well, maybe you did.
You know I didn't.
I don't know, Clary. I wasn't there. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm upset. Bound to be upset. Spooky sod standing there. I'm bound to be upset.
You don't appreciate how serious it is.
They'll find out the truth, the investigators.
They can't find the 50 quid. He hasn't got it. He doesn't seem to have spent it. They've been all through my flat. Questions. They went to see Mr. and Mrs. Reynolds. I don't know what they may have suggested. Asking me questions about you.
Questions about me?
Yeah, whether you were expensive, that sort of thing.
Expensive?
Expensive taste, if I spent money on you.
What did you tell them?
I told them it wasn't like that.
No, it isn't. Spaghetti bolognese and a bottle of Spanish red.
Well, you can't explain to them. I told them we'd been friends at Cambridge. They didn't understand. Well, then
just don't say our sort of people, Clary. Just
please.
Don't.
Look. I'll go down and talk to him. Tell him to leave you alone. It's not your fault.
Yes, it is.
Well, I'll tell him I was bound to find him anyway. It'll take him longer, that's all.
Look, leave him alone. He's not rational. You'll only make things worse. He's gone now, anyway.
What?
It's raining.
Have you found him somewhere to live? Well, I mean, if he's out on bail, he must be living somewhere. I thought the social services would have found him somewhere.
Why do you want to know?
I'd like to talk to him anyway, actually.
Well, don't the police know where he's living?
Well, I'm suspended.
What would you say to him?
Ask him why he accused me. Ask him to tell the truth.
How would you persuade him to do that?
I don't know.
Violence?
Of course not.
Well, don't you want to? He's hurting you. Don't you want to hurt him?
Well, it's not a question of whether I want to.
Well, you do want to, then.
I wouldn't do it.
Well, if you won't talk, you might have to beat the truth out of him.
I thought you might tell me where he's living.
I think you'd better go home, Clary. Leave it to the professionals.
I told them at the station I'd be here tonight. I phoned.
Well, phone again and tell them you won't.
Why?
I don't wish to sleep with you.
Why?
I've gone off you. Don't ask me why. You bloody know why.
Because I asked you where he's living.
That, yes. Because you don't learn. If you hadn't asked me and I hadn't told you the first time where he was living, we wouldn't be in this mess. You wouldn't be under suspension, and I wouldn't have a Polish nutter hanging around outside, glaring up at my window. I wouldn't have you informing the fuzz every time you come over to sleep with me. And investigators from Scotland Yard would not be inquiring about my expensive tastes. I wouldn't feel so dirty. It's not my scene, Clary. I help people, not hunt them down.
Well, I've been trying to help people, haven't I?
No, not people, Clary. You've been trying to help our sort of people. There's a difference. Publishers and pianists you've been trying to help, not people. So will you just go home?
I asked you to marry me.
I asked you if you wanted any more spaghetti. The answer to both questions was no. Just go home. I'm sorry for you. You're in a mess, but I've gone off you.
I wouldn't mind some more spaghetti, actually.
Go home!
I'll phone you tomorrow, shall I?
No!
All right, I'll phone you tomorrow.
I think
I make some trouble for you.
Yes.
So sorry.
Why?
I think you make some trouble for me.
You killed the dog. You took 300 pounds.
You shouldn't make trouble. I teach you a lesson. I
bloody well teach you
Don't
a lesson.
Don't hit me.
You stop pestering this doll, you hear? And you tell
Don't
him the truth at the station.
Don't hit me.
I never took 50 pounds. So you tell him the truth. You tell him the truth.
Don't hit me.
I wouldn't soil my hands.
We have this problem. We can't find the 50 pounds.
Well, he's hidden it, hasn't he?
Why?
Where?
What?
Why hide only 50 pounds and not the rest?
Well, it's obvious. To accuse me. Revenge.
But he'd never met you.
Never heard of you.
Until the night before he was picked up.
The night you let him go?
I did not let him go.
He was picked up next morning. The only place he could have hidden that 50 quid.
Short of digging out the pavement.
No electric drill. He lacked the necessary equipment.
Right.
Now, the only place he could have hidden that money was in a single room rented for one night on a B&B basis from a person previously unknown to him. It defies logic.
Nevertheless, that room has been searched.
Thoroughly. He's a man of few possessions, but those few have been given the full treatment. As, for instance, the backs have been removed from the pictures.
Churchill. The late Sir Winston. Some characteristic photographs.
Yeah, I know.
Books. The spines have been slit.
Churchilliana. Of no intrinsic value.
Clothing.
Nasty.
You, Constable, on the other hand...
Well, you've been over my place. You wrecked some of my books. If they'd been first editions...
Oh, you, buy first editions, do you? Go in for that.
No.
Or any valuable objects? Porcelain? Netsuki? Would they be an interest? Small, valuable objects, easily concealed?
No.
We have to ask.
You've seen my bank statement. Building society, I've nothing in it. I don't smoke, not even cigarettes. I don't drink spirits. I've no savings. We're not paid enough to be able to save.
True.
Sadly true.
There is your young woman, of course.
Well, we've been into that. Look, you didn't bring me in here on a Sunday morning just to go over a whole lot of ground we've already... I mean, it's bloody harassment, that's what it is.
The police are never off duty, Constable.
Sunday is a day like any other.
I myself rarely sleep.
I'll get it.
This is going down.
I'll see if she's in. Look, you don't have to come up. I said I'll see if she's in.
Sunday morning, she's bound to be in.
She might have gone away for the weekend.
You'd have known that. You would have to check.
What's the matter?
He wants to see Marion.
Yes?
Police. He wants to see you.
I never said I was from the police.
Well, it's social workers, man. Do you think we can't recognise the fuzz when we see it?
It's the raincoat.
All the CID you ever see nowadays are trying to look as if they're in a television series. It's sickening.
What do you want?
Oh, just a word.
Well, shouldn't there be two of you?
It's really a social call.
Oh, you can push off then. I don't entertain the fuzz socially.
Don't you?
Touché.
I'll just step in for a minute anyway, if you don't mind. My feet hurt.
I do mind.
Do you want me to do anything?
What were you thinking of doing?
All right, come in.
You're all social workers here, are you? All three of you?
That's right.
Convenient. Are you trying to grow a beard?
What if I am?
It's a mistake. You're not the type. It won't do a thing for you.
We don't grow beards to improve our appearances, as a matter of fact. We do it to get closer to our clients.
Well, don't you try. You'll never bring it off.
All right, I'll shout if I need you.
We'll be outside, Marion.
Saw you in court. Thought I'd like to meet you.
What's it about? My taste, as you see, aren't particularly expensive.
Pardon?
Aren't you meant to be finding out whether Clary's getting into debt because of me? Keeping a mistress, overspending.
Oh, there.
Well, just for the record, I keep myself. And my lifestyle isn't extravagant.
You've got a nice place here. You keep it nice. Modern. I like that.
What are you trying to say?
I was curious. I wanted to have a look at you. You're a good looker. Too good for Girly.
Are you all right in there, Marion?
She's all right.
Why do you call him Girly? He's not gay.
It's his name, Clary. Stupid name. I call him Girly. He's soft.
He's quite strong, as a matter of fact, physically.
Is he?
Don't touch me. Don't dare.
Who's touching you? I told you. I only came to have a look at you.
Well, now you have.
Yeah?
So you can go.
Yeah. Are you going to open the door for me? Thank you. See you. I know the way.
What was all that about?
I don't know. Bloody Clary. Look, if he phones, I'm not in.
I shan't phone. I'm going to give her time. Well, she's upset. That's natural.
I'm surprised they let you wear a uniform and you're still under suspension.
Well, I keep it at home.
You heard from the investigators again?
I keep hearing from them. I saw them this morning, actually. I wear it to prove to myself that I'm still a policeman. Huh. I thought I'd phone her tomorrow.
There were two of them, you know. They came here.
They were bound to?
Mm. We told them you'd never do such a thing.
Did they believe you?
Well, I'm not sure.
Why shouldn't they believe us? It's the truth. How can they prove something that didn't happen?
Well, it's difficult for them, actually. What it comes down to is my word against his.
Such a man. Who would believe him?
Well, for him to be lying, he'd have to have destroyed the money before he was picked up. They seem to have decided he can't have spent it and there was nowhere for him to hide it. Anyway, why hide £50 and not the rest? Doesn't make sense, they say.
Oh, to incriminate you. Revenge. Well, that's clear.
Well, that's what I say. They say that would mean he'd know he was going to be caught.
Yeah, but I mean, he's bound to be caught. I mean, he had his name, his description, bound to be picked up.
Well, they say being a person of low intelligence, he wouldn't necessarily know that.
Yeah, but I mean, what can they think of your intelligence? I mean, you knew he'd be caught. Well, how can you accept a bribe, knowing that?
They don't seem to have a very high opinion of my intelligence, actually.
But Clarence, why should you accept a bribe to let him go and then go to the CID the next day and tell them how to catch him?
Well, they say I might have taken a gamble on him not being believed.
Oh, ridiculous.
Well, anyway, it'd be too risky. With you two knowing?
We said we'd forget it, let it drop.
Yes, it was you who insisted on reporting it.
I wish you told them that.
Well, they never asked me. I can tell them, I will.
The trouble is, now they may think I put you up to it. Well, they're very devious, actually, in CIB.
Over the last 24 hours...
Marion, found this package on the doorstep addressed to you. Rattles.
It would have come through the post if it were a parcel bomb. They wouldn't have left it on the doorstep.
Who'd send me a bomb? Open it.
Chocolates. There's a letter.
What does it say?
Uh-huh. Dear Miss, inverted commas, guess who?
Oh, God, no.
Here is your Judas payment. Hope you enjoy. Your boyfriend, inverted commas again, well, that's Clary, I suppose, will be fired. So end all pigs. You should keep away from such. Believe me, a friend.
What does he mean, Judas payment? That doesn't go with chocolates.
Chocolate money. Coins in silver paper. 30 pieces of...
How stupid.
Well, it's better than a... Oh.
What?
It's not chocolate.
You're joking?
No.
Marion, you want to know what your friend Kowajinski just sent me?
I once had a client who used to piss in his hat.
We found him a place near the World's End.
Appropriate.
Not far from the Chelsea football ground. I don't think he's a supporter.
Just give me the address.
Look, you didn't need to come
over. Just give me the address.
I didn't ask you. I was upset. I lost my temper. If I hadn't been in a state, I wouldn't have phoned.
You said you never wanted to see me again.
Well, I do think we should cool it a bit. Oh, for God's sake, Clary, it's such a mess.
Just give me the address.
No.
But he sent you
No! You're bad news, Clary. All right, it's not your fault. For God's sake, what have you got me into? I get visits from the fuzz, this bloody nutter sense...
What fuzz?
Oh, I don't know, CID or something, one of those. Came to take a look at me, he said. Spooky. And then he went away. I get you phoning all week.
They said you were out.
I told them to. Look, I'm not giving you Kowajinski's address. I'm not giving you anything. It only leads to trouble.
But somebody's got to stop him pestering
you. Not you! Look, if there's anything to handle, I'll handle it. You just keep away till this whole mess is over. We'll see each other again. We're friends.
Friends?
What do you want me to say? You don't own me. Do you think you're the only man I ever go to bed with?
Just give me the address. Right!
Don't do anything stupid!
Many of the football fans who have come to London for the match appear to have been provided with forged tickets and have consequently been unable to gain entrance to the ground.
Always the football.
I thought we might get another dog.
Snuffing game's finished, mate. Snuffing well over. Greedy sod, give it here. Get off.
Tell the truth about me.
You haven't done either, have you?
Chocolates! What did you think you were doing? Did you want her to eat one? Filthy, kinky bastard! Don't laugh at me!
Are you all right? Mr. Covisions?
Okay. Now go home. Now come on, son. Don't play games.
Come on! You still got his nephew truncheon?
Thank you.
Kowajinski, who has accused Police Constable Clarence Duhamel of accepting a bribe, has been pestering Clarence's girl, Marion. Angry, Clarence follows him, catches him in a deserted basement area, and batters him savagely. Later, Clarence becomes involved in a fracas with football hooligans and is stabbed. His attackers run off with his truncheon and dispose of it.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
It's not a pay bed. I was lucky to get it, really. They do have a few rooms they keep for people who have a special need for privacy.
Do you have a special need for privacy?
Well, no, actually. It's more the other patients not wanting a policeman to overhear what they say. It's awfully good of you.
I'm a publisher. Books are easy for me to get. No one else seems to want them.
Oh, we brought you an evening paper. There's a photograph.
Is there?
Page 7. Does it hurt?
Only when I laugh.
Here, let me.
They're letting me out soon.
Where will you go? To your family? You need rest.
Well, they're not very keen on my going home, actually. You see, my parents live in the Wirral. It's a long way.
They?
The investigators, the bribery thing.
Oh, that's ridiculous.
Well, they say I have to keep myself available. I'll go back to my flat and rest there.
Ned.
It's not a bad photo, is it? I wonder where they got it.
Ask him how. There's a spare room. He's all strapped up. He can't go back to his flat. He needs care.
Are you sure you can cope?
Of course.
Did you read it? The boy says I saved his life. Well, it's a bit of an exaggeration, actually. But they were putting the boot in, poor little devil.
Clarence, would you like to come and stay with us?
Pardon?
When they discharge you from hospital, would you like to come and stay with us for a little while?
Oh.
I suppose the police investigators won't have any objection to that?
No. No, I don't suppose they will. As long as they know where I am.
It's settled, then.
Come in.
Hello, Duhamel. Hope you're feeling better. I'm Inspector Craig. We haven't worked together, but you probably know me by sight. You know Detective Sergeant Holbrook.
Yes. Mrs. and Mrs. Reynolds.
How do you do?
I do. Well, that's at the station sent you there.
Oh, thank you.
Reynolds! Didn't you own the dog?
Yes.
Sad business. Miserable.
Yes.
Well, Duhamel, they tell me you're well enough to talk.
I think you should know that it...
Yes, Mrs. Reynolds.
My wife would like you to know that it was, in fact, Constable Duhamel who himself insisted on reporting the escape of this man, Kowajinski. We were prepared to forget about the whole thing, but he insisted. It's inconceivable that he should have been bribed.
Oh, that's all right, Mr. Reynolds. I think we can forget about all that.
Oh?
Now, if a complaint is made, it has to be investigated, you know, but there's no proof, no proof at all.
Well, I'm very glad to hear that.
Well,
would like us to go.
Please, I don't want to rush you.
You'll come back tomorrow.
Thank you. Do you want the paper?
No, no, of course not. You should send it to your mother. She'll be very proud. I'm so glad this business is all over.
Ah, yes, it's finished.
Au revoir, Clarence.
Au revoir.
That French?
Oh, she's a pianist. She's played at the Wigmore Hall. They're awfully nice people, actually.
They brought you the paper?
Yes.
Had a chance to read it?
Not yet. Well, just the bit about me.
Yeah, have a look at mine. It's a later edition. I've marked the place.
Man found dead in vandalized property.
Yes. Your friend, Kowajinski.
Oh.
Interesting coincidence.
Pardon?
Interesting that he should have been killed in the same vicinity.
As what, sir? Says he was found in a basement in Uverdale Road. I'm not sure where that is.
World's End. Not far from where you had your little adventure. I don't mean to disparage it, Duhamel. You displayed great courage.
Thank you, sir.
But you'll agree it was in the same vicinity.
Well, I wouldn't describe it like that, sir.
How would you describe it?
Well, I was in the vicinity of my own home. I live in Fulham.
Yes, and you'd been
I think you know that, sir.
Well, remind me.
Well, I'd reported my whereabouts to the station as required. I've been to visit my girlfriend in Lavender Hill.
It seems odd that Karjinska should have been living so close to you.
Well, I wouldn't know that, sir.
Wouldn't?
Didn't.
Your girlfriend would have known. It was her department found him the room.
Was that where he lived, sir, Overdale Road?
Near. He was killed in the vicinity of where he lived. Your girlfriend would have known where that was.
She wouldn't tell me.
He asked?
Yes.
Why?
He'd been pestering her. He regarded her as being in part to blame for my having been able to apprehend him.
How, pestering her?
He sent her a... Well, it seemed to be chocolate, sir. Chocolate coins wrapped in silver paper, 30 in a box. 30 pieces of silver, where he considered that she had betrayed him. However, they were not chocolate, sir. Excrement, sir, in the shape of...
Oh.
Yes, sir, would it upset her?
Aye, it would.
I asked her to tell me where he lived so that I could reprimand him. She refused. After a bit of an argument, I went home. On the way, there were these hooligans beating up a small boy.
Yes.
Well, I think you'll agree, sir, that even if I'd found the man, it's hardly a motive for murder.
Was I accusing you of that, Constable?
You seem to be hinting, sir. You said it was an interesting coincidence.
Oh, well, it is. Any detective will tell you coincidences do happen when they do their interesting. Of course, in this business of motive...
Sir?
It's not just the insult to your girlfriend. He had accused you of accepting a bribe.
You said yourself, sir, there's no proof. And it's not likely.
All right, no proof either way, but unlikely a man of your character would accept a bribe. Very aggravating for you, though. Who do you think would kill Kurjinski if you had to pick a suspect?
Well, I don't know, sir. I don't know the man. A man like that, he must have had enemies.
Ah, yes, we'll make all those inquiries. Past neighbours. Of course, they wouldn't know where he lived either. He was a man that moved often. Still, they might have got in touch. Polish community, church, local shopkeepers. Trying to find out who knew him, how he spent his time, all that sort of thing. It's routine stuff, but it usually brings results. And then there's the murder weapon.
Have you found that, sir? It doesn't say.
Blunt instrument removed from the scene of the crime, presumably by the murderer. What does that suggest to you?
Well, either that he wasn't wearing gloves and took the weapon away for fear of fingerprint identification.
Or?
That it was something he brought with him. I don't know why we're saying he or she. It could be anyone.
No, murderers are always he, unless there's evidence to the contrary. Battered to death, you don't think of a woman. Imagine that kind of thing. There doesn't have to be a motive for murder, you know. Somebody that got a bit cross with Kurjinski might just have gone that step too far. Somebody that was only trying to teach him a lesson. Why were you in uniform, by the way, when you're under suspension?
I'm entitled to wear it, sir.
I'm not sure that's an answer.
I didn't take a bribe, sir. The complaint was a lie intended to discredit me. I've been wearing uniform as a sort of gesture, actually.
Oh, I see. Well, forensics should tell us.
Sorry?
The blunt instrument, what it was. Forensics should be able to give us a pretty good idea. When we find it, it's bound to carry traces of hair, blood, that sort of thing. Even the actual shape of it, to fit the shape of the wounds in his head. It's extraordinary what forensic can do nowadays.
Yes, sir.
Look, don't make too much of this question to Hamill, but what happened to your truncheon?
Well, I think you know that too, sir. My attackers ran off with it. I'd like to have it back, actually.
Service this time, you see. It's an official call.
anything else? We seem to have been over the same ground rather often.
Oh, I'd like to get it straight, Miss Dole. It's a case of murder, you know. Yes, well, shall we have it again? Are you positive that...
Excuse me. Hello?
Yes. They're here now.
Clarence came here in response to a phone call from me. He asked me to tell him where Kojinski was living. I refused to tell him. He went away in a huff.
And you're sure that you gave him no...
Hint. I gave him no hint. I deeply regretted having told him at all about the chocolates. And I wished to be sure of keeping him and Kojinski apart, since clearly no good could come of bringing them together.
Was that him on the phone, by the way?
Him?
Just then.
The boyfriend.
Ex-boyfriend. He's having a little difficulty in accepting that. But it was he, yes.
And I thought you two were so close.
I find I've gone off the force.
Oh, don't be like that, Miss Dole. We do our best to protect the public, you know.
Well, have you finished?
I just wanted to be sure.
Please be sure. To the best of my knowledge, since Clary was suspended, he hasn't even seen the man.
Oh. Sorry?
Since you're so interested in my private affairs, this is my current boyfriend. I think you two have already met.
Yeah. That's right.
Right.
Glad you have come.
Won't they be following you?
I'm not a prime suspect. I haven't really got a motive. Anyway, it's natural for me to want to see you.
No, it isn't. I told you to keep away and stop phoning me.
I'm staying with the Reynolds. They're awfully nice people. I wish I could meet them.
Well done, old boy.
I think you may be something of a prime suspect, Clary.
I told you, there's no motive.
You know there is.
Well, not enough. Kill someone.
No.
Love 30.
Did you do it? Okay, I know it's none of my business, but I would like to know. I've lied for you, Clary. Well, not lied, just not told the whole truth. I said I refused to let you know where Kawajinski lived.
You did?
Yes, I just didn't mention that you didn't have to know, because he was hanging about outside and you could have followed him home. So once again, I'm involved. You've involved me. I could bear to know what actually happened.
Nothing. I lost him.
So it doesn't matter then if I tell the whole truth next time they question me.
Well, I'd rather you didn't, actually. You know what they are.
Yes. I know what they are.
Marion?
Now you know what I've said to them and what I'll go on saying to them. I've done all I can for you. I shan't undo it. If he's dead, he's dead. There's only one thing might make me change my mind. I never want to see or hear from you again. I really mean that.
You need to set the match, old boy.
Are you watching me?
You know I am, girlie.
All right.
Broke it off, has she?
What?
Finito. Can't say I'm surprised. You're not the man to satisfy a girl like that. She needs a real man, girlie. You're not the man. It's obvious, sir. He wants to know what story she told us. She gave him the reassurance.
But they went off separately.
Ah, she got his new boyfriend, sir.
You didn't actually hear any of this?
No, sir, but it was obvious.
Just as it's obvious she was lying when she says she didn't tell him how to find Korzynski.
Yes, sir.
It's an important point of detection, surely, to make allowances for the fact that a subject under interrogation might actually be telling the truth.
I don't think many people tell the truth, sir.
Perhaps you don't encourage it.
Sir?
People usually behave in terms of your expectations of them. Show them you expect them to lie and they'll do so to please you. It's a point of philosophy.
I'm afraid that's a bit above my head, sir.
You reach up for it. You might surprise yourself.
If you'll excuse me, sir. First, the man Korzynski left these fake chocolates in the hope the girl would eat one. She didn't, of course, but she can imagine. I mean, it's obvious she'd be upset. So, second, she phones Dummel. He comes round to see her. They both admit that. She's angry, she blames him. It's obvious she told him where the man Korzynski was living, and he went round at once to teach the man a lesson.
At her request?
Well, it's possible.
That would make her an accessory.
All the more reason for her to be lying.
Maybe, but meantime, there is this unfortunate lack of any hard evidence.
Pull him in, sir. He's got no backbone. Under interrogation, he'll confess. Intensive interrogation, sir.
Thank you, Constable.
Sir?
Chorley seems curiously eager to secure a conviction.
He doesn't like Dehamel, sir. He's got this chip about education and that sort of thing, class. Well, he's 35, still a detective constable. Bound to have a bit of a chip.
Aye. You'd think a man to whom so much is obvious would rise higher.
Yes, it's all right. Sorry.
We'll have to pull him in, our Clarence. We'll have to pull him in. He's bound to break under the interrogation. Only I'm not convinced.
Of what, sir?
I'm not convinced he knows that Korzynski didn't die of the battering. He died of suffocation.
I don't see why I shouldn't go back on duty. They've dropped the bribery investigation. It's no reason to suspend me any longer. When the wound's healed, there's a scar, but I could do a duty. They took my uniform away for analysis. I don't see what there was to analyze. They haven't found the truncheon. It's hardly my fault if kids run off with it. I had a knife in me. There wasn't anything I could do. They haven't found the kids, of course. Well, you can't really blame them, I suppose. I didn't give them much of a description. And the boy they were beating up, I'd never seen them before. They just picked on him because he was a Chelsea supporter on his Todd. Stupid to be on his Todd in that situation. No, they'll all be back in Macclesfield by now. Manchester, Liverpool, Birmingham, wherever it was. Preston. One of them was West Indian, I think. Black, anyway. I said to Inspector Craig, he's the kind of man who has enemies. Someone like that bound to. Not just the anonymous letters. He was a Churchill freak.
Freak?
He had a picture of him with a candle burning in front of it, actually. Well, you can't tell me that's not perverted. Of course he had enemies. Black magic, I wouldn't be surprised. You make enemies. There's a whole routine. In a case of murder. There's a whole routine. Neighbours. Places of resort, whether he's got anything on the HP, if he's in debt. If he killed your dog, he could kill others. He might have been pushing drugs. Well, that's the sort of thing they should be inquiring into instead of... They've
They went to see Marion. She hates policemen. She won't see me now. Did I tell you she won't let me see her?
Yes.
Well, I expect they are doing this, you know. You know, making routine inquiries. It's not just you that they're questioning.
We were very close. Marion and I. Oh, we've been intimate. Because they don't approve of that in the force. I asked her to marry me.
You know, I expect they're questioning everybody who has the slightest possible motive. It certainly was a nasty piece of work. I mean, once told, one ought to understand people like that, but I confess I find it very difficult.
I lie awake at night, thinking. I can't sleep. When I do sleep, I have nightmares.
Have you been thinking of getting another dog, Clarence?
They've been very good to me. I don't know what I should have done, just waiting around in my own home. Yeah, you couldn't call that a convalescence. You couldn't call it rest. I'm very grateful, actually.
Would you like me to play something?
Oh. Please.
Didn't you say that you were a bit of a singer, Clarence?
Well, I did some at Cambridge. We did a production of Fledermaus. I was Alfred.
Oh. Do you know the waltz in Act One?
Yes, yeah, I do. I still sing it sometimes.
Right, hello.
In the bath, actually.
Oh, good, good. Singing round the piano, it's very gemütlich.
Yes, isn't it?
Ready?
Drink, my darling, can't you see? Best accept what has to be. Life's a sickness past the cure. Drink assists us to endure. Laugh and wear your brightest face. Shake away the tears. Hide in some secluded place cares and pain and fears. Love's a game for many players. Change your partner, start again. To persist in such affairs only leads to pain. Drink with me, laugh with me. Just accept what has to be. Live with me, love with me. This dream that has to be. Drink with me, love with me. Just accept what has to be.
I was only trying to teach you a lesson. They're bound to find out, actually. They're bound to catch me.
threatening of violence in the district where he lives, police constable Clarence Duhamel, temporarily out of control, batters the man who has been harassing him and his girlfriend Marion, now his ex-girlfriend. Clarence had no intention of killing him, but the man is dead.
We found the kids that took your truncheon. Well, that was easy enough. Takes time, that's all. You know how it is with kids. They talk, boasting. Knife and a copper, that's something you tell your mates. Of course, there were four of them. They couldn't hope to keep it quiet. They all spoke very freely, cooperated with our inquiries. They'll plead guilty now. What's the word?
Hassle, sir?
They'll all plead guilty to GBH, no hassle. All makes work for the probation service. So, that's two matters cleared up at once. We've caught four football hooligans who stabbed the policeman. And we know what happened to your truncheon. Then, of course, there's the report from forensic. Blunt instrument. Kurjinski, the dead man, was battered about the head with a blunt instrument. Several blows. Oh, that's full of technical details. Scientists, they don't write straight English. It won't mean anything to you, Duhamel, unless you've got the jargon at your fingers' ends. Put in a nutshell, forensic won't say exactly what was used, but they can tell us a great deal about its distinctive shape. The actual shape of the wounds, you see, Duhamel. That tells forensic a great deal about the shape of the weapon used to inflict those wounds. It's distinctive shape. And you know, forensic, they're apt to be cautious. They won't say at this stage that the man, Kurjinski, was battered to death by a police truncheon. Only that he could have been. Of course, the murder weapon itself would bear traces of blood, hair, scalp tissue.
I think you know, sir, I was obliged to use my truncheon in an attempt to prevent the four boys from beating up...
Yes.
It's in my report of the incident.
Actually break their heads, did you? Or any one head? I mean, did you in actual fact inflict wounds on one or any of the four boys consistent with the discovery of blood, hair, fragments of scalp tissue on your truncheon?
I've got a right to consult my solicitor before I say anything.
What?
Under the judge's rules, I've got a right.
Yes, you have, you have. Who is your solicitor exactly?
Well, I haven't got a solicitor, actually. There's my father's solicitor.
Where does he practice?
Wallasey.
Merseyside. Long way for him to come. Anyway, the rules don't say anything about long-distance phone calls. I'd be the villains phoning the Prime Minister of Iceland.
I'd like to phone Mr. Reynolds. He'll find me a solicitor.
You don't have to phone him. I'm asking him to come and see me. You've only got the right to one phone call to Hamill. Don't waste it. You can talk to him when he comes in.
I'm not saying anything. Except in the presence of my solicitor.
Clarence, you're behaving like a guilty party.
Now, don't make Sir cross. All we want is for you to assist us with our inquiries.
I can't remember if I broke any of the boys' heads. It all happened at once.
Well, I think I can tell you without betraying any confidence that they don't have the injuries consistent with it.
One of them grabbed my truncheon, one of them stuck a knife in me, and they ran away. It's all in my report.
Well, they spoke very freely, those lads. Yes, they were a model to you in that respect. Yes, we know exactly what happened.
Detection, it's all a matter of detail, really. Asking questions, eliminating possibilities.
That's what we're trying to do now, Clary. Eliminate you as a possibility.
They want me to go down to the station.
Well, must you go?
They want me to go and see them.
Who?
The police.
Do you have any choice?
I shouldn't think so. Clara's been arrested. Well, not arrested. He's assisting them with their inquiries.
Yeah, right.
Stupid.
Well, you could be an accessory.
I don't know he's done it. He told me he hadn't. I didn't tell them any lies. Well, the half-truth isn't a lie. It's not my fault if they don't ask the right questions. I said I refused to tell Clary where Kojinski lived, and I did refuse.
And if they do ask the right questions?
I don't know. Don't know what I'll say.
Yes, well, we'll both be along. You're Mr. Reynolds and Miss Dole. You had a meeting with Miss Dole the other day, I understand. Julie's been keeping a friendly eye on you. It's the coincidence, you see. You and Kojinski being in the same vicinity when he was killed. And the murder weapon, of course. What did you talk about?
Pardon?
You and Miss Dole in Battersea Park. What did you find to talk about?
We have plenty to talk about.
Yes?
Private matters. I think you know already, sir. She doesn't want to see me anymore. I've been trying to persuade her to change her mind.
Look, as far as I've heard, you've been trying to do that for some time. I'm surprised she even bothered to meet you if that was all there was on the agenda. Didn't you want to know what she'd told the police?
Well, obviously.
You did want to know?
Yes.
Why?
A man can be innocent and still be worried.
You wanted to know if she'd confirmed your story?
I think you know, sir, I had no opportunity of speaking to Marion between the time you saw me and the time Sergeant Holbrook went to her house. I was in hospital.
Yes, you must have been worried. And did she confirm your story?
It's the truth. You know she did. Anyway, it's not my truncheon.
What?
I don't know why you've shown me that truncheon, sir. It's not mine. I have very keen vision, actually. I can see the number at the top. If you do have my truncheon, sir, I'd like it back if Forensic are finished with it. And my uniform. They've had that for a week. There should be plenty of time to do a full analysis.
Don't you get stroppery with me, boy. It doesn't suit you.
You know how much football violence there was that night. Those four louts would have killed that boy if I hadn't broken it up, and they bloody nigh did kill me. Actually. Knives, bottles. You say you've eliminated people. Well, anyone could have beaten him up in a basement. If you'd found my truncheon with any of his blood or hair on it, you wouldn't be asking me questions. You'd have charged me. There's no connection between me and him. I didn't know he lived at the world's end. I was on my way home. You're just trying to make something out of nothing.
Take him down, Charlie. He needs time to cool off. I'll see you again, De Hamel, after I've had a word with your friends. It all takes time. Pity he doesn't smoke.
Just make yourself comfortable. Try not to keep you too long. Just got to get one or two things straight.
Comfortable.
Oh. Smoke if you like.
Everyone needs someone to talk to.
Yes.
The lad's under a strain.
Yes.
He's been staying with you and your wife since he came out of hospital.
What are you asking me?
If you've noticed anything, if he's said anything, maybe he talks in his sleep.
Well, he's not been sleeping with me. Or my wife.
A man is dead.
Clarence tried to help us when our dog was stolen. Because of that, he's in trouble. Now, I would have expected him to have gone to stay with his parents when he left hospital, but it seems you wouldn't allow him to leave London. We asked him to stay with us. He's been a guest in our house.
You haven't answered my question.
Well, I think I have.
There is a legal obligation, Mr. Reynolds, on the public to assist the police in their inquiries. Now, if he said anything, made any confidence, any indication...
Shall I assure you then that he hasn't?
No, I'd rather you left the question open. See, murder. It's not a question of murder. De Hamel's not that sort of a lad. We both know that. But if he lost his temper, if he was provoked in any way, good God, there was provocation. I've known a man walk free from the courtroom after a conviction for manslaughter when there was provocation. And De Hamel doesn't understand that.
Have you told him that? Have you promised him anything?
He's weak. A nice enough lad, but weak. And like all weak men, he can become obstinate. He needs a friend to advise him.
And you want me to advise him as a friend to plead guilty to manslaughter?
I want to know what happened exactly. I want to know the truth.
He needs a solicitor to advise him, I think.
There's no occasion for it. He's not been charged.
How long have you been holding him here? It's dark outside.
He's assisting us with our inquiries.
I think that he's entitled to see a solicitor. Now, if you've no objections to that, I will arrange it for him.
No objection. A bit late in the day for a professional man.
Yes. Well, tomorrow morning, then?
Tomorrow, by all means. Yes, it's well dark. Pull down the blinds, Charlie, will you? I'm sorry you were not able to assist the lad.
Won't keep you long.
You have kept me long.
This is a murder inquiry, you know. You don't seem to understand the seriousness of your position.
I understand the seriousness of my position very well. I want to go to the lavatory. Women, do you know? No need to escort me. I'll find my own way.
Yes,
well. Hello, Miss Dowell.
She wants to go to the toilet, sir.
All right, in a minute. We'll get one of the women constables to show you the way.
Big deal.
She doesn't seem to understand the seriousness of her position, sir.
Well, look, I've told you everything I know, many times. You can't make me an accessory when I've been telling the truth.
Oh, truth's a relative creature, Miss Dowell. A statement can easily be changed. We expect that.
Not mine.
His.
What?
It's taken time. He's finally admitted.
What?
He asked. You told him.
What?
Kojinski's address. It's only a matter now of tidying up the loose ends. Rephrasing your own statements. It'll take no time, then you can go to the...
I shan't be rephrasing my statement.
What?
I don't care what Clarence may have admitted. You've your own ways of making people admit to falsehoods, I've no doubt. That doesn't alter the truth. Clarence did ask me, but I would not and did not tell him where Kojinski lived. And now I'll go to the lavatory, if you don't mind. It's quite urgent.
Down the corridor.
Second on the left.
Did he, sir? Admit?
Oh, don't be a bloody fool. All right, De Hamel, now let's have the facts. You didn't mean to kill him, we'll accept that.
I couldn't have killed him. I didn't know where he lived.
We've had Miss Dowell in. She's been very open with us, very frank and honest. She's admitted it.
Admitted what?
You knew.
I didn't.
She's admitted she told you.
If she said that, it was a lie. Anyway, I don't believe she did say that.
All right. Let's do it the hard way.
I didn't know where he lived. I didn't know where he lived. I didn't know where he lived. Sorry.
We'll all need our sleep. It's been a long haul, Clary.
Yes, sir.
Do you feel you've been under any undue pressure? Ill-treated in any way?
No, sir.
Let him go.
Take him down, sir.
Let him go. You remain under supervision. Report your movements and keep yourself available for further questionings. I'll make arrangements for you to get your uniform back since it's so important to you. Thank you for your assistance. Good night.
Off you go. Oh, no, you're stopping.
was all that about? He did it. We know he did it. Just a bit longer, he'd have cracked.
That's not the reason why.
Mrs. Reynolds, it's Clarence. They let me go. Yes, isn't it? Can I come over and see you? Well, I was thinking if I could come over this afternoon. Well, there's something I want to get first, actually. Tea time, lovely. Yeah. Au revoir.
Drink with me, laugh with me, just accept what has to be.
On the one hand, we can't charge him. There's no case to answer. And from this morning, we'd have had a solicitor making trouble. Now, on the other, I'm reasonably certain, although we can't prove it, that de Hamel did know how to find Kojinski and that he did batter him. But there remains the unexplained and awkward fact that Kojinski didn't die of it. In my experience, Ken, when you're faced with an unexplained fact of that nature, your best course is to put matters back to where they were and see what happens.
What are you doing here?
Been following you. My job, that is.
That doesn't mean you're entitled to come barging into my flat.
Been shopping.
Don't you know I have?
Knife? Yes. Why?
Oh, for God's sake.
Just asking.
No sinister reason. It's a cook's knife, French. Mrs. Reynolds has been very good to me. I wanted to give her a present. She's keen on cooking. Well, she's continental, so just put it down, would you please? I want to gift wrap it.
Sure.
Well, you don't have to hang about. I'm not going anywhere.
No.
Anyway, you've got no occasion to be following me. I haven't done anything.
Haven't you? I think you have, girlie.
Don't call me girlie. You know I don't like it.
I think you battered that old man, that nutcase, that pole. I think you followed him home and battered him. That's my opinion.
Well, you're wrong, actually. They let me go.
They're wrong, actually.
Bloody stupid. Everybody's wrong but you, I suppose.
That's right.
Well, what are you waiting for?
For this reason, girlie. Bit cold, Nia. You should have your fire lit.
For this reason. I tell you no lie. For this reason, girlie. Not dead yet. Takes a little while. Not long. It was me who killed that old man, the Pole. You couldn't kill a rice pudding, girlie. You couldn't even break the skin. But I was following you. I was following you, following him. Just for the interest. And when you left him lying there like that, well, he was in agony. I put him out of it. Kindness, really. Miserable old nutcase like that. Give me a hand, girlie. The fingers around the handle. And now you've gone and suicided yourself with a knife specially purchased for the purpose. Case closed. I like to be neat. Case closed, girlie.
Clary's late. That's not like him. He's not met you yet, but I'm sure you'll get on.